The PCN tour you just watched is available on VHS or DVD for $29.95, shipping and sales tax included. To place your order, call 1-866-PCN-VIDEO or visit our website at www.pcntv.com. Take a walking tour through Pennsylvania without taking a single step. PCN Tours does the footwork for you when we take you inside Pennsylvania's factories to show you how things are made. Just put yourself in the hands of a production expert and let them show you around. There are more things made in Pennsylvania than you think. Next week, PCN Tours American Refining Group, Sunday night at 8.
This is PA Books, featuring authors of books about Pennsylvania's people, politics, history, and business. This week, L.A. Tarone discusses his book, We Were Here Once.
L.A. Tarone, author of We Were Here Once, Successes, Mistakes, and Calamities in Hazleton's History. What do you mean by the title, We Were Here Once?
I'm not specifically sure that came where that came from. I remember at one point, I guess when I was a little kid, we were coming back from Knoebels, my mother, my father, my brother, and I remember stopping someplace, and my mother said to my father, hey, Louis, we were here once before, and it just kind of stuck. And I said, hey, that's an interesting title because it's about Hazleton's history, a place where Hazleton was at one point.
For people who are not familiar with it, first of all, a couple basics, where is it?
Where is Hazleton?
Yeah.
Roughly 45 miles north of Allentown, 25 miles south of Wilkes-Barre at the top of the hill. Population somewhat in dispute. Officially, according to the Census Bureau, roughly 23,000 people, but the only people who believe those numbers are the Census Bureau. The social service agencies, the school district numbers, and that put the city's population more at about 33,000-34,000, where it used to be at one time. We were over 40,000 at one time in the 30s and then began a decline as coal declined. Economy of the area, still somewhat centered in manufacturing, a lot of warehousing, service sector employment. There has been an effort to recruit technology jobs, white-collar jobs, computer, internet-related jobs. And it's met with, I suppose it's fair to call it, a mixed degree of success. It hasn't been as successful as was originally hoped for, but it hasn't been a complete disaster either. So we're hanging on.
What is it about Hazleton that made you want to write a book about it?
Well, first of all, it's my hometown. And Hazleton has, for much of its history, been sort of the stepchild of northeastern Pennsylvania. It's part of a three-city area, of course, with Wilkes-Barre and Scranton being the other two. But it's the smallest of the three, although not that much smaller than Wilkes-Barre. And it's always been kind of left out. It's the Wilkes-Barre-Scranton Airport, not the Wilkes-Barre-Scranton-Hazleton Airport. They're called the Wilkes-Barre-Scranton Penguins, not the Wilkes-Barre-Scranton-Hazleton Penguins, though in fact any public money that comes to fund that hockey team is from Luzerne County, so it's paid for from Wilkes-Barre and Hazleton. Scranton isn't involved in the finances of it at all. And for years in radio, when I gave their scores, I referred to them as the Wilkes-Barre-Hazleton Penguins, which didn't go over real well up there, yeah, but so that was part of it. I don't think the city's history had ever really been investigated, if that's the right word, and explained in sort of a realistic context. There have been several history books written about Hazleton, and there were always the positive, happy side of Hazleton history. We all went to church, we went to Hazel Park on the weekends and stuff like that. In fact, Hazleton was a very wild town. It was an exceedingly important town. At one point, we were among the 100 biggest cities in the country the first few decades of the 20th century. The anthracite production, in and around Hazleton was exceedingly important in the development of the Industrial Revolution. And the textile industry in Hazleton was very strong. A lot of people would be surprised to learn that at the turn of the century, the largest textile operation in the world, the largest silk mill in the world, was in Hazleton. The what we call the Duplin Mills, founded by J.L. Duplan, who moved his operation here from France in 1893 to get around the Dingley Tariff Act. It was actually cheaper to produce here rather than import here. That was all based in, and all of that was in Hazleton.
They were making silk in Hazleton?
We were for many, many years. Yes, the building still stands. As a matter of fact, the publisher of that book is in that book. The Duplin Silk Mills actually closed in 1953. It's now technically called the Sargent Art Industrial Complex. And there were a number of smaller manufacturers in there. But to those of us who grew up in Hazleton, that will be the Duplin building forever.
Well, people usually think of silk manufacturing as being something that takes place in China or India or someplace
In Duplin's case, it began in France. It was woven into a lot of different things. And as I said, he moved his operations. He had several plants around the state. He had one in Dorrancetown, which is now called Dorrance, about halfway between Wilkes-Barre and Hazleton. He had one in Nanticoke. His first one was actually a smaller one in Bethlehem in about 1894, 1895. And he started looking around for a place to build a larger operation, and the old Hazleton Board of Trade, the forerunner to the Chamber of Commerce, pulled a fast one on him. They told him the city's population was 25,000 when in fact it was about 14,000, and they told him they had this beautiful, pristine piece of land on what was East Diamond Avenue. It was known colloquially at the time as no man's land because there was scrub brush, there was open sewer pipes running, it was a mess. The story, at the Standard Speaker, we have their 20th commemoration booklet that was published in 1918. And the official corporate line from the Duplin Silk Mills was that J.L. himself was on his way out of town. He said, forget it, we're not staying here. But he supposedly ran into school children who were being let out of class for the day, and they were really taken with this man who came with the fine French clothing and all this kind of stuff. And he said, well, you know, looking at these kids, maybe there is a future here. And he moved there in 1898. What we call the Duplin Building is actually three separate wings. They were built, the original one in 1898, then there was another addition in 1908 and another addition in 1909. And for a while, that was the largest silk mill in the world.
Well, I want to back up a minute about Hazleton's location. Why is it where it is? Why is there a city there?
Basically because it was the halfway point between Mauchunk and Berwick, which were two towns that had developed earlier because of the fledgling railroad industry. It appears that the first building in town was a bar that was opened by Jacob Drumheller in 1809, approximately where Broad and Wyoming Street meet today, as sort of the halfway point for travelers who may be going from one town to the other. Then the Beaver Meadows Railroad opened in about 1835 or so. That's only a few miles outside of Hazleton. And then, of course, coal was found around the same time. And since there was the beginnings of a town already there, it just grew because of the coal. And then the financial men followed afterward, and then the textile industry in 1893. It really isn't a great location for a city when you think about it, because there's no waterway nearby. Most cities grow up along rivers, deltas, something like that. The nearest sizable waterway is the Susquehanna River. It's 25 miles away. So if you were planning Pennsylvania today, and you were looking for a place to put a city of 30,000 people, where Hazleton is probably not where you would put it.
It's also on the top of a mountain.
Yes, yes, it's the highest city in Pennsylvania, 2,100 feet above sea level, which has also brought with it its own set of unique circumstances. Our winters are a little colder than they are elsewhere in the state. There's times when it's raining in Wilkes-Barre. We have 4 or 5 inches of snow on the ground in Hazleton that has made, particularly in the early days of the railroads, it made transportation a little more difficult and that sort of thing. So it's not an ideal location, but hey, that's where we are.
You say in the book it's not politically correct to refer to Hazleton as a coal town.
Right.
Well, first of all, why is it not politically incorrect, and is it a coal town?
Hazleton is a coal town. It was a coal town. It was founded because of coal. It grew up because of coal. That statement is perhaps 3 or 4 years outdated now. When I began writing that book, that was absolutely true. Since then, a lot of the so-called movers and shakers in town have come around and stopped it. For a while, there was a concerted effort to downplay Hazleton's coal history and try to make it appear to be a manufacturing city and whatever else. As a matter of fact, our mayor, Lou Barletta, has talked about building an amphitheater up there, which is a fairly controversial proposal. But a friend of mine was involved in the planning of that, and he had a name for it. He wanted to call it the Black Rock Performing Arts Center. Cole. This is 2005, and it was rejected because they didn't want a real tight connection to coal. And I don't understand that. I don't know, in the minds of some people in positions of authority, and I'm talking, you know, the Chamber of Commerce types, those types of people, somehow being related to coal is somehow, I suppose, antiquated. And, you know, you got your hands dirty from it and all that kind of stuff. And maybe that's not the image the commerce class wants to portray of Hazel. Nevertheless, that's our history. That's where we came from. And I don't like the idea of history being politically corrected and the coal aspect of it being. Yeah, we're a coal town. Sure we are.
Is there still coal mining going on in the area?
Yeah, not a lot. There are a couple of mines that are still open. There's strip mines. We haven't had the shaft mines for many, many years, although not too far away at Tremont and Tower City. They're still operating. But in and around Hazleton, there are a few strip mines open. I don't know the production figures off the top of my head, but I can't imagine it's more than a few hundred thousand, maybe even just a few thousand tons every year, as opposed to the several million that it used to be. But yeah, there still is something of a coal industry.
Well, when it was at its peak, was there mining going on actually in the city?
Oh yeah, inside the city limits. As a matter of fact, the remnants of the shaft breaker is still standing, and the pits that were around it are still there, and that would be, if you look at a map of Hazleton, it's on the east end off Diamond Avenue and Cedar Street, toward the Hazel Township and Stockton number 6 and Ashmore and all those little towns out there by where the beryllium plant was. Yeah, that was all inside the city limits. As a matter of fact, where the Broad Street Shopping Center is now, that was reportedly the very first mine in town. And John Charles is said to have discovered coal, anthracite coal in the Hazleton area there in 1826. He was reportedly digging for a groundhog. And it's sort of similar to the Necco Allen story. The Necco Allen story, he was out in the woods one night at the top of Blue Mountain, and he started a fire to keep warm. He got up the next morning and noticed, hey, this rock is still burning. And that's how we discovered anthracite coal and Pottsville grew. Well, the Hazleton story is somewhat similar. John Charles was apparently looking for a groundhog or something in the woods. And he started digging. He found all this black coal and said, hey, look at this. And then it boomed once the railroad opened and Ariel Pardee came to town and there was a way of transporting it out of town.
If someone who's never seen a breaker or a stripping, or if they visit Hazleton and just tour around, do they see
Well, unfortunately,
remnants?
Not really. There are some remnants still around. The big breakers, unfortunately, aren't around anymore. Now, there are a couple that aren't too far away. The Hubley Breaker is up in Ashley. That's only about 20 miles away. And then there's the St. Nicholas Breaker between Shenandoah and Mahanoy City. That's only about 15 miles away. But the big important ones in and around Hazleton, unfortunately, are all gone. And there was one, and I have some pictures of it in the book, Jetto Number 5, that was one of the few breakers I've ever seen that was actually put together with an eye for aesthetics involved. Most of them were very Spartan. They threw them up together quickly, they put the equipment up, and then they kind of wrapped a shell around it that became the building. In this one, there was some fairly intrinsic brickwork and, something of a decorative facade. And unfortunately, that was torn down about 25 years ago, about 1980. So all the real breakers are gone. There is still a shell of a breaker in the Eckley Miners Village, which is about 12 or 13 miles out of town. But that really wasn't a breaker per se. That was built up. That was built to simulate a breaker for the movie The Molly Maguires that was shot there in 68 or 69. There are still some pits and stuff like that. And out toward Harwood and Hollers Hill, there are still some mine shanties left, miners' washrooms and things like that. And like I said, there are still some pits, still some silt banks, still dot town around town and that. But the real remnants of the industry are pretty much gone.
Well, when you were putting this book together, did you come across stories that kind of drew you in and took on a life of their own?
Yeah, very much. That originally started, my first thought was maybe slap a book together of some old pictures I had, because I'd been fooling around with photography since the 70s, and frankly, I was never that good at it. But I had a bunch of pictures that I had taken in the 70s. Then in 2002, I went on a camera buying spree, and I bought all these strange Eastern European cameras, which took great pictures, and I had much better aptitude with them than I did with German and American cameras. So I started running around trying to take pictures of whatever remnants was left. That combined with the demolition for the Pine Street neighborhood project, as it's called, of an old factory whose architecture I love, really got me interested in looking in that era of Hazleton history, and I learned lots of stories that were printed in the newspaper that I had never known about before that really drew me in, and it became addicting. I'd get off work at 11:30, go upstairs in the morgue, as we call it, and I'm there till 4 or 5 o'clock just paging through newspapers going, wow, I never knew that, you know. It was fun.
What is the standard speaker?
The standard speaker is the local newspaper. We've been in existence in one form or another since 1866. So it makes us one of the older papers in Pennsylvania circulation. I guess we're about 25,000 or so.
Daily?
Daily. And maybe a little more on Sunday. It's actually the continuation of three separate papers, the Hazleton Sentinel, the Daily Standard, and the Plain Speaker. And over the years, over the space of about 40 or 45 years or so, they were all combined. The Walzer family owns the paper, and it has been involved. Frank Walzer, who was the second owner of the Sentinel. So the Walzer family has been involved in the Standard Speaker and its predecessor since about 1890.
So it's locally owned?
Yes. Yes, we're one of the few left.
Speaking of the pictures here, what's the cover photo there?
I wish I knew to whom to give credit for that. That is a gorgeous picture that I found floating around. That is Broad Street. It is taken from probably the second or third floor of the Altamont Hotel. That is Broad Street, just west of the intersection of Church Street in about 1945. If you look very closely on there, the building farthest to the left at the time was an A&P supermarket. The main frame of that building is still standing. It's the Ferrara Center for the Performing Arts now. It had been renovated. It was an ice skating rink or a roller skating rink for a while and all that, and it extensively renovated. The rest of that block has long been torn down. There was a YMCA in there. There's the Grand Theater up at the other corner. That was the they were all victims of what was called Downtown South, which I write about extensively in there, which was a redevelopment program in the mid and late 1960s into the early 1970s that virtually decimated Hazleton's skyline and came very close to wiping out what historical buildings were left in town.
It seems in reading this book that you care very much about that.
I do. Even when you look at our system, like Wilkes-Barre's a little hard to draw a correlation because the flood, Agnes in 72 wiped a lot out, and of course the one before that in 36 wiped out some of what had been left before that. Taking a look at Pottsville, which is Hazleton's sister city, 27 miles south, a little smaller in population, but they have managed to save. The Necco Island Hotel is still standing. The old female grammar school is still standing. You drive around Garfield Square and it still looks like Garfield Square. Hazleton had similar structures, similar neighborhoods, with a similar historical bent, and they're all gone. And it was done starting in, I guess, about 1964, 1965, with what was called Downtown South. It was the primary example of a city that took what was the current thinking of redevelopment, dived in head first, only to find out years later that, well, wait a minute, maybe this isn't going to work, because they took a 16-block area and basically leveled it with no real plan for what would replace it in the hope that something at some point would. And our newspaper, as a matter of fact, was kind of supportive of it in the beginning. By about 1968, 1969, 1970, it started asking some really hard questions. All right, you just level this neighborhood, what's going here? And we're getting answers like, well, it hasn't yet been defined. There are several possibilities. There were architectural renditions, quote unquote, that were presented as real plans. That when you look at them all these years later, they look like not a lot more than somebody just doodling with a pen and a paper. Some of the plans were really far out. There was one I remember in about 1973 or 74 for an ultra-modern hotel affiliated with one chain or another. I don't remember which one. And it was said to be more modern than what was in Las Vegas. Well, now let's be realistic. This is Hazleton, okay? This isn't going to happen. And in fact, the plot of land where that was targeted to be built was left vacant until about 1992 or 1993. So it sat vacant for over 25 years. It was a horrible thing. It was started with the best of intentions because the coal industry had really dropped off. The mines in the area got hammered 2 years in a row, 1954, 1955, a Hurricane Diane and Hazel. I forget which one was first. I think it was Diane, then Hazel. Maybe it was Hazel, then Diane. But in either case, you had an unemployment rate in and around Hazleton in 1955, 1956 of 25%. So we were in bad shape. CANDU was started with the Dime a Week campaign to try to recruit other industries. But in the meantime, downtown is deteriorating badly. There's a lot of open storefronts, vacant storefronts. Things are deteriorating. The neighborhood that was leveled, as a matter of fact, got the colloquial nickname of the Bowery at one point. Still, there was some tax revenue coming in. There were historic buildings there. The Majestic Hotel comes to mind, the train station, the Feely Theater. And there were still people who lived there. I don't believe that any of that was taken into account when Downtown South was started. They basically mapped off an area, leveled it, and hoped something would develop. And it was so fraught with so many calamities, that was perhaps where the title came from more than anything else, was from Downtown South. They didn't bother to consider relocation costs.
You say that they had to pay the cost of moving if they moved a business or a family.
Right.
They had to pay the cost.
Right,
of that.
And I don't think they realized that in the beginning, because the standard speaker again really started pressing them as to what that cost in the mid 1970s, and they were throwing up figures like $400,000, and I don't think anybody believed they were accurate. And the paper at one point termed the family relocation hopscotching. So if you had a building on Broad and Vine Street you were going to tear down, and there was another building on Wyoming and Chestnut Street that you were going to tear down, well, you moved them from this building that was condemned to this building, and you tore this one down. Then when you went to tear this building down, you moved them to another condemned building. That's insanity. But that was done for like 4 or 5 years, and who knows what the final cost was. And actually, taxpayers nationwide and statewide should be a little annoyed at all of that, because the original HUD grants were supposed to be 75-25 matching share. Well, during the Schapp administration, the Commonwealth decided it would pick up half of Hazleton's share. It would pay 12.5%, and Hazleton would pay 12.5%. By the time Downtown South ended, Hazleton paid nothing for it. It bought back the rest of the federal money it owed through tax credits and all this kind of nonsense. So all of that happened with no local expense, very little final local expense at all. However, there was a tremendous cost in aesthetics, the relocation cost, the lost tax revenue, all that kind of thing.
Did any good come from it?
I guess in that there were buildings that were torn down in that neighborhood that probably should have been torn down anyway. There were things that were not missed. If you drive through what was that neighborhood today, you find two HUD-financed high-rises for the elderly and a privately owned high-rise for the elderly. They were eventually built there, but it was after several years. Did some good from it? Yeah, it did. And had that have been, had Downtown South been run the way the thinking of redevelopment planning is today, where you take a block at a time and have a project ready to go, so as soon as one building goes down, another project starts, I don't think you would have had people, me, such as myself, our former mayor, John Quigley, a number of other people who have been extremely critical over Downtown South over the years because of its, you know, tear down and hope something will grow attitude. That's what was the real mistake in all of that.
Another thing you seem taken with and write about extensively in here is the industrial workers of the world. Who are they?
The industrial workers of the world are colloquially known as the Wobblies. They were a radical labor union that was formed in Chicago officially in 1905, though they were sort of put together by remnants of other radical unions, such as the Western Federation of Miners, where Big Bill Haywood came from. They had a significant presence in all of eastern Pennsylvania, quite a presence in northeastern Pennsylvania. One of the offices that were raided in the Palmer raids, in fact, was the Scranton office. They had offices in Reading and Philadelphia, and conducted the textile strike of 1913 in Hazleton, which I detail, that appeared to be pretty much a warm-up for what happened in Patterson the Helvetia silk mills. That's pretty well remembered in Hazel American history. But there were several other textile strikes that were kind of a warm-up to that. One was in Lawrence, Massachusetts, and the other one was in Hazleton. And if you follow the timeline of what happened in Patterson, everything that happened in Patterson had been done in Hazleton a couple of weeks before. It's as though Hazleton was sort of the warm-up for what would happen in Patterson. Patterson was bigger, was a bigger textile town than Hazleton. So it was like, well, let's try it in AAA before we bring it to the majors. Right down to them collecting a strike fund and then running out of town with the money.
What made the Wobblies a radical union?
The belief of their founders, Elizabeth Gurley Flynn and Big Bill Haywood and some of the others, they were anti-capitalist. You really weren't using the term socialist and communist at the time. But that's what they were. Their slogans were things like, you don't need your boss needs you, overthrow the wage system, and we reprint a number of their posters from that period in there. And they had what appears to have been at least an indirect tie to the Bolsheviks in the Soviet Union. There were AP stories in 1918, 1919, after the Wobblies were arrested, where the federal government produced letters that had come from Moscow that had promised funding. Now, oddly, when the Soviet Union finally fell and a lot of the documents were declassified, the earliest funding they could find of American anti-capitalist labor parties was in about 1919, but there are a couple of things to remember. That the Soviet Civil War was still ongoing, so things had been moved a lot, things had been destroyed, the capital had been moved from St. Petersburg to Moscow, so a lot of things were lost. But at the time, the government produced what appeared to be pretty solid evidence that there was a connection between the Wobblies and the Bolsheviks. And of course, Big Bill Haywood defected after he was arrested. And released on bail. He defected to Moscow, and half his remains are behind the Kremlin wall. So I think there is a pretty solid connection, and I do think they were responsible for a number of violent incidents in eastern Pennsylvania, including around Hazleton.
So the Wobblies found receptive potential union members in
They certainly did at the Duplin silk mills. The other mill that was very close by was the Jacob Gerhardt Shirt Factory, which was the first major textile operation in Hazleton. It opened in 1894. Gerhardt had come here from Austria, and unfortunately he's been all forgotten. And it was the demolition of his old factory that really got me started doing this whole thing, as a matter of fact. He treated his employees pretty well. He paid them higher than the average. The work day was shorter. So when the unions came to town and started trying to organize the textile workers, they didn't meet with much success at Gerhardt's, but they did at the Duplin. First, it was the American Textile Workers Union. But in 1913, when they walked out the second time and ATWU came down looking to recruit members, the Wobblies also came to town. And they promised more. The workers had been dissatisfied with a couple of earlier strikes, ATWU's actions in the earlier strikes, so they affiliated with the Wobblies. And things took off from there.
Forgive me if we jump around a lot, because there's a lot in your book. You write about a couple of mining disasters, too. Is it Jeansville or Janesville?
It's Jeansville. That remains to me one of the most amazing examples of how much people can endure if you really have a will to live. These guys, there were four of them, they were trapped underground for almost 3 weeks, 20 days, with no food, no water, and they survived. They had little, if any, schooling at all, but had an innate intelligence to know how far they could go before they would kill themselves. For example, they ate whatever they had. They ate money, they ate shoes, they ate mine paper, whatever they could get their hands on. But they didn't have anything really to drink, because you can't drink the mine water because it's so full of acid. Well, after they got out, the leader of them, a guy named Joe Motchowitz, went into detail saying, well, we did boil it. They started fires. They boiled the acid out of the mine water, but were intelligent enough to know that you can't keep the fire burning for a long period of time because the carbon dioxide is going to kill you. So they knew instinctively when to put the fire out and have potable water and to be able to survive for that long. It's a fantastic story that I really thought somebody would resurrect when the mining disaster happened in when those miners were trapped in West Virginia a couple of years ago. And unfortunately, nobody did.
They ate rats' legs?
That is one story. We go into detail in there. At that time, there were a lot of newspaper writers who, if they couldn't get a real story, they simply made one up. Of course, there were people who say we still do that. But so when the miners were removed from the mine and put in the hospital, reporters were not allowed to talk to them. The doctors wouldn't allow it. So a lot of reporters just simply made stories up and passed them off. One of them was that story about rat legs. That still survives. That is, I believe...
866-PCN-VIDEO. Or visit our website at www.pcntv.com.
Read any good books lately? Any about Pennsylvania? PA Books goes between the lines to bring you the faces behind the pages. If a subject has roots in the Commonwealth, the authors of PA Books have something to say about it. Next week, the author of Pennsylvania Breweries, Lou Bryson, Sunday night at 9.